And maybe if I don't know whether there are questions on previous lectures, otherwise I'll leave you the floor, Alex.
Okay. Yes, please, if there are questions, tell it now. It's better. We can solve it now. If not, I will start sharing my screen. Can you see that?
Yes, yes.
Thank you. So today I will start with one thing that I forgot to tell you last day. I'm sorry. So we will do a kind of reminder about the intrinsic dimension. Okay, we were talking the first two lectures about dimensionality reduction, as we see that if your points are something like that, you can map it to 1D easily by using principal component analysis. But if your, let's say, your manifold in which the data lies, it's much complex like this one, there is no way PCA can work. I mean, PCA cannot work because it performs a rotation of the space and try to obtain the maximum variance directions. But if it's something like that, the rotation is useless, right? So we introduced, just let's say, in a really, really shallow manner, other methods that can deal with this kind of problems. I put here the references that I will give you when I gave you the slides. That would be tomorrow, let's say. And you see that here, okay, we can have some of these methods working, but how do we know which dimension are we going to use? Okay, if we are lucky and we are using what it's called a spectral method, that is PCA or other variants, like it can be kernel PCA or isomap, and we have a nice gap in our spectrum, we know which dimension we are going to use, right? It's going to be this four in this case, right? If we have this kind of gap, it's, let's say, natural to decide which dimension we are going to project. But imagine that none of these methods works, or we don't have a method that is working and we don't have a gap. So how to decide which dimension should we use? What we have to do is directly estimate the ID. And probably the older method for doing that is the box counting method. Imagine that I have these two distributions. If I sit in this point and I want to plot the number of neighbors of each point as function of the distance to the point, okay? If I sit in this point, what I would see is that, okay, in this case, I have three, I have another quantity. And I see that in this case, the number of neighbors of my point increases with the square of the radius from the point, right? If I, in this other situation, what I have is that when increasing the radius, I have a linear increasing of the number of neighbors. Why? Because at the end, what I'm trying to show you here, pictorially, do not take it, let's say, it's not that here I count the, but pictorially, this is the trend. And what happens is that the number of neighbors of a given point scales with the distance to this point to the D, where D is the dimension of the manifold in which the data is involved. And here we have a prefactor that is the density. So if I take the logarithm of this equation, I have a nice linear dependence, right? So what we do in the box counting method, it's one of the versions of the box counting method, it's just taking all the points in my data set and obtain a list of k nearest neighbor, where k is a parameter. And we obtain the neighbors and the distances to these neighbors. And then we fit this equation with the log linear fit, and we obtain D as the slope of the curve. Okay? That's a really easy method, but have some problems. Among the problems that it has, it's what happens if the density is not uniform. This equation is not hold, this equation is still hot, but this dependence is not linear anymore, because this log of density would not be a constant term, right? So in the cases of the, in the density is not nearly uniform, let's say, this method will fail. And also in the case that the manifold is curved, if I go for, imagine that instead of having this line, you have a curved line here. When you start going far from your point, you start, let's say, cutting your money, your manifold, right? You will start having, okay, distances. Let me try to design here. Okay. Imagine that you have something like that. I hope you can see the points. But when you start watching the distances, the first one is still in a line. But the second one starts cutting the manifold. The manifold should be something like, let me write it in a different way. Our manifold would be something like that, right? And what we are doing with this method is to compute distances that are outside the manifold. So that's also a problem for this box counting method. Therefore, people are developing constantly new methods for estimating the ID. Let me explain you one that is the one that we employed for this course. And before explaining you, I want to explain you one probability of points at constant density. Imagine that I have these points at constant density, and I sit in one of them. Okay, now it's just a sum of one of these points. This is one of these points, and I compute the shells, the volume of the shells of the nearest neighbors around each point. Okay. You see that this is the shell defined by my first nearest neighbor. This one is the shell defined by the second one, so on so far. Okay. What it happens is that these volumes are distributed with an exponential distribution. Okay. And this exponential distribution allows us to derive, for instance, the formula of the k nearest neighbor for the density estimation that we are not going to explain you today, but it's one of the utilities of this formula. The other utility of this formula is that it allows us to derive another method for estimating the ID. Okay. Imagine that we take this quantity, that is the ratio between the distance from the second nearest neighbor in front of the distance from the first nearest neighbor. Okay. I can show by using the previous probability that this quantity is distributed according with a Pareto distribution. Okay. And the magic of this method is that by assuming only that the density within the second nearest neighbor is constant, this expression becomes independent on the density, because you are taking this ratio that cancels the dependence on the density. Okay. But if you have that, I'm not going to derive that here. If you are interested in the derivation, you can check the reference that I put here. But just by using this, you can also apply maximum likelihood, that is not more than the product of the probabilities of each point. And by taking the logarithm and maximizing, you obtain an expression for D. Okay. And this expression for D, it's easy. It's the inverse of the average of the logarithm of this quantity. And it has an error associated that it's the relative error. It just depends on the square, on the inverse square root of the total number of points. Okay. Is it clear? Okay, I will stop here and ask you for questions. Are there questions about this method or the previous one? Okay, if there are no questions, we can go back to clustering. Okay. So let's go back to clustering. And just in the last lecture, we were talking about methods of flat clustering, and I explained you k-means. Methods about from using fuzzy clustering, where we saw that the assignment is not so clear. And I explained you fuzzy means. And we have shown also methods of hierarchical clustering. And I didn't explain you the methods of hierarchical clustering. So let me, today we are going to introduce the methods for hierarchical clustering, and let's see if we are arrived to point to other methods that are more advanced. Okay. So let's start talking about hierarchical clustering algorithms. And in hierarchical clustering, there are two main types of hierarchical clustering. One are agglomerative methods. In these methods, you start considering all the points as individual clusters. And at each step, you merge the closest part of pair of clusters until you have only one. Okay. In divisive cluster, the approach is the opposite. You start considering all your points belonging to the same cluster, and at each step, you split your clustering, okay, until each cluster contains a single point. Okay. I introduce both because historically both are considered, but let's say that in practice, the only one that people use are the agglomerative ones. And this is mainly due to the fact that divisive clusters are extremely, extremely computational demanding. OK. Okay. So let's see how these methods work. I mean, the basic algorithm, it's really easy. It's just start computing the distance metrics between all the input data points and assume that each point is a cluster. So to start to iterate by merging the two closest clusters, and then you update the distance metrics. What means updating the distance metrics? It means that once you merge two clusters, you have to consider how to compute the distance between clusters, not anymore between data points, but between clusters. And this is the key operation, and this is the key difference between many, many agglomerative clustering algorithms. Each of them has a different definition on what is the distance between a cluster. Okay, let's see it in practice. Imagine that you have these 6 points. Okay, as I told you, at each step, you pick the minimum distance and merge these elements. Okay, so what you would start, it's just drawing an axis that is the joining distance. Okay, and I pick the minimum distance and merge these elements. In this case, the minimum distance is between elements 5 and 6 that are the two nearest points. So I pick them, I put them in my graph, and I say that they are joined at this distance. Okay. Then I take the second one, let's say, and I take the distance between 3 and 4. And I write that I make them the same cluster at this distance. I label the first cluster, cluster 1, the second cluster, cluster 2, the third one, cluster 3. And now, what should I do? It's the critical point is how to compute the distance between these clusters. Okay. There are many solutions. We are going to see some of them. The question is that each cluster is a set of points. Okay. So we have to think about how to transform a set of distances in a single one. Okay. Probably the older alternative and still quite popular is the single link distance. And what it takes is that when you compare two clusters, you take the minimum distance between them as the distance between the clusters. Okay. How it applies? In this case, what I would say is that the distance from the cluster 1 to the cluster 2, it's the distance between the two nearest objects that are 5 and 4. The same, let's say, from cluster 1 to cluster 3, the two nearest objects are 5 and 2. And from 2 to 3, the two nearest objects are 0.2 and 0.3, okay? So what I do is to pick the minimum distance of all of them and join, in this case, the minimum distance is between 2 and 3, right? So what I do is joining these two clusters and then consider them as single one. And I repeat it. And in this case, the distance is just between 5 and 2 that are the nearest ones. And I already joining them here. Okay. This is how single linkage works. And it has some advantages and some drawbacks. Let's see the advantages. Imagine that you have something like that. You will obtain the two clusters, okay? Let's say you will obtain a tree where the two main branches will define the two clusters, okay? It can handle kind of easily non-elliptical shapes. Whatever shape have your clusters, you will obtain correctly with Single Linkage. But if you have some noise, like it's the case, this noise will kill you, the definition of the clusters. Because by just looking at the minimum distances, you are really sensitive to noise. Okay. And in the cases that there is noise, it tends to really elongate the cluster. So you finally don't see a clear structure. Okay. Another way of defining the distance between two clusters, it's what it's called the complete link. And in the complete link, it's the opposite. Instead of taking the minimum, we are taking the maximum distance, okay? In this case, it's not going to change a lot, but it's going to change the definition of the distances. You can see that the distance between a cluster one and cluster two would be defined by the two farther off objects that are points 3 and 6. The distance between clusters 1 and 3 would be defined also by the two farther objects that are 6 and 1. And the distance between 2 and 3 would be the distance between points 1 and 4. Okay, so I pick again the minimum and I joined the two clusters at the minimum distance, which is this one, right? Then I continue once joined. There is a question in the chat. What happens?
Yes, there is a chance.
Yeah. Okay, I will just let me finish here and I will replay. Okay. So once you have that, you have to compute again the distance between these two clusters that came from the maximum distance, and then join them, okay? And that's all for complete linkage. Let me replay the question. What happens if, for example, we have a line of 3 data points in which each 2 points are near each other, but there are 2 points that are farther away and does not fit the distance threshold to be considered a single cluster? Does that raise a problem in this approach? Sorry, I cannot. I don't fully understand your question. Could you unmute yourself?
Yeah. Do you have my voice?
Yes.
Yeah. So what happens? So the idea here is to find the 2 data points that are near each other. Yeah, to find the nearest neighbor.
2 clusters. Okay.
Yes, but at first you start with 2 data points.
Well, in this case, yes. Yes, you start with all the data points.
Yes.
Each data point is a cluster.
What happens if, for example, 1 and 2 are near each other, mm-hmm. and there is number 3 that is near number 2, but is further away from number 1?
Okay, the question is what you say in...
So there's a line that... Number 1 is near number 2 and number 2 is near number 3. So we can consider number 1 and 2 as a cluster and number 2 and 3 as a cluster, but 3 and 1 are not in the same cluster. So
because the question is that what is a cluster depends not in a distance threshold. Mm-hmm. Depends on the method that you use for building your clusters, right?
So the
reply to your answer would be depending on the method that you use.
So if we use the distance,
happens? But if you use the single linkage distance, uh-huh. you will obtain a kind of worm-like cluster, okay? In which you have a line of points that will belong to the same cluster. If you use this complete linkage, it will probably split your clusters.
Uh-huh. Okay. But if I may, so usually the distance satisfies the triangle inequality, which means that the distance between point 1 and 3 in your example cannot be larger than the sum of the distance between 1 and 2 and 2 and 3. So, I mean, if your distance satisfies the triangle inequality, then I think you have some guarantees that the type of situation you think about do not realize. There is another question in the chat.
I'm trying to understand. In your example, where there was a noise between the two clusters, application of which of the introduced clustering methods will result in two clusters as the answer? Okay, it, for instance, in this case, let me finish it. This clustering method will generate two clusters, this complete linkage, for instance. Okay, but let's continue seeing methods, and then if it's not clear at the end of the lesson, I will try to replay that. Okay. So, for instance, if you have something like that, you will obtain the two clusters. Okay. The problem, okay, it gives you more balanced clusters and it's less susceptible to noise. But it has a problem. Imagine that you have two clusters that are really unbalanced in your data. This method is anyway force them to be balanced. Okay, so the balancing of the clusters in this case would be generated by artificially imposing through the cluster method. It's not that the method naturally will know this. They are balanced, okay? So by using this complete link clustering, what happens is that all the clusters tend to have more or less the same diameter. So small clusters are kind of ignored, okay? There are other distances that we are going to explain you a bit faster. For instance, this one is the group average distance, in which you just say the average distance between two points, okay, two clusters. It's a kind of compromise between single and complete link. And however, it's still biased towards really globular clusters. Okay. Another one is considering the centroids for it. If you remember the centroids for k-means, in this case, what you do is considering the distance between two sets of points as the distance between their centroids. It's also, and also there is, I mentioned it, I'm not explaining that. It's the worst distance, but it's probably the among the most employed. It's a bit, the formula is a bit complex, but it's a kind, somehow it's an hierarchical equivalent of k-means, okay? So that's why it's so employed. Whatever the problem is that group average, centroid, worth distance even, they tend to be biased towards globular clusters. Let's say if your clusters are not globular, your result will probably not be what you want, okay? But the other method that allows you to deal with, let's say, clusters of any shape, that it's the single linkage, has the problem that if you have noise, you are going to obtain bad results. So it's not easy to decide which hierarchical clustering you are going to use. Okay. Okay, I don't know if there are questions about these methods.
No questions in the chat.
Okay. So if there are not questions, up to now, I explain you what are considered the classical methods for clustering. These classical methods are mostly these, the ones that I explained you, and they are still widely used, but there are thousands, I'm not exaggerating, thousands of different method, clustering methods. That's maybe hundreds, I don't know. So we cannot see all of them. And the idea is that all the methods that I explained you to till now have problems. Some of them you are really writing, but there is not a universal solution for clustering. Okay, so people it's developing methods for clustering. And I will try to explain you two methods today that we will have time to explain you that are kind of successful and try to and are kind of natural, connatural to physics, okay? One method is the expectation maximization clustering. Okay. What's the basis of this method? The basis of this method is that you have a model, and in your model, you consider that your data came from an underlying probability function, okay? Then you assume a functional form to this probability function, and you estimate the parameters by maximum likelihood. Let's put one example. Imagine that you have these two set of points, right? You will agree with, I think, Magdier, I will ask you your question at the end, okay? I will give you an answer at the end of the lecture. Okay, if you have these points, what you can do is saying, okay, I assume that they came from a probability density function that is the sum of two Gaussian functions, right? Then I put, let's say, randomly my Gaussian functions, and then I optimize the parameters of the functions. Once I have optimized these parameters, I can have a partition of my data according with the Gaussian function that generated them. Okay. This is a, let's say, this is a really, really nice way of cluster, because it allows you to really understand the your points, your clusters, as coming from an underlying probability function, but you will see that it has problems, okay? First of all, let's see how you do it. What you do is to use an iterative procedure to compute the maximum likelihood, okay? At the beginning, you estimate the data given the observed data, okay? And you estimate how, let's say, the assignation of your points. And then once you have this assignation, you estimate the parameters by maximization. Okay. And let's see it in an example. Okay. Imagine that you have a mixture of K Gaussians. Okay. A mixture of K Gaussians is defined by a weight of each Gaussian and a Gaussian function that depends parametrically on omega parameters, okay? In this case, of course, the weight, if this is normalized, this weight must be some one, if these functions are also normalized. And these parameters are nothing else than the average, the mean, and the covariances, okay? So what I assume is that all my points belong from this mixture of k parameters, of k Gaussian, sorry. And I try to estimate the parameters that are the weights pi and the omega, all the parameters of each Gaussian, by maximizing the likelihood or the log likelihood, right? So by maximizing that, I will obtain parameters and omega. How to do it? That's where the method starts working. But the idea is that each point is probabilistically assigned or is generated by one Gaussian, okay? So you can estimate the probability that a given point is generated by a Gaussian by means of this formula, okay? Where you are taking the values of the Gaussian function at the data point, right? Once you have this probability, you can use it for estimating the effective number of points of your Gaussian, right? But it's nothing else than the sum of all the probabilities belonging to the to this Gaussian, okay? Once you have that, you can compute the a mean and a variance, right? But once you have these two parameters, you can recompute these weights. This is the, what the expectation maximization does. First, you evaluate your weights. Well, you initialize your parameters, your variances, and your mixing coefficients, and then evaluate the log likelihood. Once you have that, you evaluate your weights. And once you evaluate your weights, you reevaluate the parameters. And then you evaluate the likelihood and you stop at convergence. Okay. Once you have that, you have, let's say, all, you have the probabilities that your points are generated from a given Gaussian. That is a kind of fuzzy partition of your data, right? And then you have your model. The problem is that, well, let's say, first of all, let's say that it's kind of really similar to k-means. In general, since k-means is really, really fast, people initialize the parameters of a of expectation maximization by performing before a k-means. The problem is that if your model is not realistic, let's say the functional form, there is not writing in any place that your points must be Gaussian, for instance, or the k is not correct, your results will fail, right? And then there is the additional problem that this expectation maximization, it's a local optimization. So there is no guarantee that you reach the global minimum. Okay. So before going to the next method, that is the last one, let me see if there are questions. Okay, you cannot. I will reply you to the end. Are there any questions about this expectation maximization algorithm? Okay. If not, I'm going to explain you another method, and we are going to finish here. The method that I want to explain you, the last method that I want to explain you, it's called fast search and find of density peaks. And the idea is kind of similar to the one that came from expectation maximization. is that if you have this distribution of points, they came, you will agree with me that you have these five clusters, right? But they came from peaks in the density of points. Okay? And it means that there is an underlying probability density function, which in this case, it's not Gaussian. It's whatever form it has, your clusters are defined by the peaks of this function. And what you try to do is to identify these peaks in order that you can identify the clusters. Okay. These cases, what you do, it's a bit different in the sense that you don't want, you don't know the model. You don't have a model. You just say that your clusters are peaks in a given probability distribution function. Okay. So how the method works. One concept that we need to know for understanding the method is the delta, okay? What it's called the delta. Imagine that you have these clusters, these points in two dimensions. One thing that you can do is to compute the local density around each point. Computing the local density, it can be do it kind of easily by, for instance, counting the number of points within a given radius, or looking at the distance of the k nearest neighbor, or more advanced methods like kernel density estimation, KNN. But let's forget about that. How do you do it? In practice, you can just, let's say, counting the number of points around each point. Okay. You will agree with me that in this case, the density is 7, for instance. The density of 8 is 5, because you have 5 points there. In this case, the density of 0.10 is 4, because you have 4 points within the radius, and on, and so on, so far. And then for each point, you compute the distance from all the points with higher density and take the minimum value. Okay. In this case, the distance from 8 to 1 would be this one, while the distance from 10 to 9 would be this one, right? What happens? This is a key concept to identify the density peaks. Why? Because if I plot these distances as a function of the density, what I see is that the density peaks are the outliers of this graph. And this happens because the peaks, the density peaks by definition, are points that are dense, so would be in the right of this graph, the right part, but are also far away from points that are denser than themselves, right? Because if it's a density peak, by definition, it cannot have a point denser nearby. So by computing this delta, that is the distance from points that are that have higher density, you can identify the density peaks or the centers of the density peaks. Then in this algorithm, what you do is to follow the density profile by assigning each point to the same cluster as its nearest neighbor of higher density. Okay? So you identify these two points as clusters, and then you follow the density profile in order to assign all the points to a given peak. Clear? You see that in this method, I didn't need to tell to the algorithm the number of clusters, right? They just pop up. And this is an advantage that it's common of many density-based algorithms. Are there questions? I listened somebody, but okay. Delta, it's nothing else than the distance to the nearest point with higher density. Clear? It's the, of course, this quantity is undefined for the point with highest density, right? Because I don't have a point with the density that is higher than my, that the point of highest density. So in this case, what it's done is to assign the delta to a value that it's big by definition, let's say. You compute the deltas of all the other points, and then you say that the delta of the point with highest density is, let's say, 10% higher than the other one. So this is not even an algorithm. I mean, you have a distance matrix between each data point, and then you compute the densities. The densities can be either the points within a radius or a kernel density estimation, something like that, okay? Then you compute the delta, which is that. It's the distance, the minimum distance to a point with highest density, okay? And then you plot the decision graph. You plot delta as function of the density. And then you obtain the outliers in this graph, and you assign them as cluster centers. The only free parameter is how do you compute the density. For instance, if you use a cutoff, it's the cutoff that you use for compute the density. But it's the only free parameter in this method. And it's relatively insensitive to this, in the sense that what is important is not the absolute value of the density, but the relative value. Okay. So doing that, what you do is, okay, if I have this probability density distribution, I sample points and I obtain, imagine that these are my data points. If I compute the decision graph, I obtain this. And if these five are my outliers, I obtain these points, this cluster partition, okay? The advantages of these methods are that they are kind of well-suited for whatever shape your cluster have, okay? They are kind of independent of the noise because being focused on regions of high density, the noise region is not so important, okay? And the outliers, it's just by looking, you find them by looking here, looking at the graph. I see that these five are outliers, okay? You identify in this version of density peaks, that it's already a bit old, you identify these peaks by hand. Okay, that's something I'm going to explain now, the black points, okay? I didn't explain it yet. So the black, now, once you have that, you need to somehow, I want to explain you how we identify these black points. And what we use is to the concept of halo. What is halo? The halo, imagine that you have this density distribution, okay? And instead of looking at that as a density distribution, let's look at that as if it was this mountain. If you see a climber here, I think you will agree with me that this climber is climbing this peak, right? If you see a climber here, you will agree with me that this climber will be climbing this peak. But what happens if the climber is here? You don't know which peak this climber is going to, right? He can go to this peak or he can go to this other peak. What we do for identifying the noise, the halo points, it's saying, okay, if I have something like that, I identify my peaks, I then identify my clusters, but the problem is that the points that are above the barrier between these two, okay, this saddle point in the middle of the two peaks of the cluster of the distribution, I'm not sure about which peak are they going to climb. So I assign them as halo, as noise, as outlier, okay? For doing that, you need to define what's the border between clusters. It's a bit technical, I'm not going to explain you now. Also, because I want to reply the questions. So let me try to replay the questions now. If there are, before replying the general questions, are there questions about density peaks? If there are no questions, I will try to reply the general ones. Okay. Are there any measures to help us choose the best clustering method based on specific data? I think Matteo already replaced you. The problem is that unless, well, let's say, in practice, the method is, okay, let's use clustering methods that already work for my data kind. Okay, so what you do is try different methods in data for which you have already an answer and see which method is the one that better fits your data. And then you apply it to your data. That's what you do in practice, because if you don't have let's say this kind of data, what you do, it's just to, unless you, well, it depends if you have an intuition or you don't have an intuition about what's your data. If your data, imagine that your data came from a simulation of molecular dynamics. In simulations of molecular dynamics, what you usually have are clusters that are defined by densities, okay, by density peaks. So usually there you use kind of density-based methods. But if your data it's generated from models in which you know, for instance, Matteo can correct me here, but for instance, in economic data, I think you usually assume that the clusters came from mixture of Gaussians, right? Or mixture of functions. Well, your face is not like really convinced, so.
Oh, I mean, there are all sorts of clustering methods that are used.
Also applied there.
Essentially, there is a theorem that tells you that there is no single best clustering method.
Yeah, that's a problem.
There are many criteria to find what is the best clustering method given your data, mm-hmm. based on internal criteria, external criteria, And then also one that we proposed based on Infomax. It's a jungle.
Yeah. The problem is that in 2 hours it's difficult to explain all this stuff. So let's say that in practice, what most people does is checking that the method works in data that is similar to the ones that you have. If it's like that, you can be somehow confident that your method will not give you strange results. And then there is the other question. Let me read it. You can answer. I'm interested on the hierarchical clustering of semantic dataset. Starting from a feature vector which describes its document, in your opinion, do you think that it's better to create a similarity matrix between the elements of the database and then compute the clusters of the resulting network? Or do you think it could be better to implement hierarchical clustering directly on high dimensional data given by the feature of vectors? It depends on how many data you have and how many features you have. I mean, in general, the problem is that if your data is not really a big, big data data set, you have to deal with the curse of dimensionality. So unless, it depends on also the intrinsic dimension of your data. I mean, it's not the number of features, but the intrinsic number of features that your data have. If your intrinsic dimension is low, I would go directly working with the feature vectors. I mean, the clustering algorithm should work well. If your intrinsic dimensionality is big when compared with the number of data, then you somehow need to reduce the dimensionality, because otherwise the curse of dimensionality will kill you and the distances will be meaningless. And this means that many of the distances in your data points would be almost the same. So what would happen is that at this point, you will obtain partitions that are not so meaningful. It's really an equilibrium between the number of data points that you have, the intrinsic dimensionality of your data, and the method that you employ. But I would try to go, I mean, I would try to check the intrinsic dimensionality of the data before making a decision on that. And I think that's all. If there are no more questions, we can finish here. I hope you enjoy last lecture of Marcello, because it's about our last work together, and that's all.
Okay, thank you very much, Alex.
Welcome.